simplicity itself made manifest. This theme is a statement, a bare fact. Beethoven always started with a fact, an axiom, and his art consists in examining that fact with so universal a range of vision that the axiom becomes living experience. In this sense, the Eroica Symphony is perhaps the supreme example of that art. And in these few minutes that we have, we shall try to understand through the Eroica something of the great mystery that is Beethoven's dialectic, the wedding of simplicity and complexity. We begin at the beginning with those two whiplashes of sound that shatter the elegant formality of the 18th century. Beethoven's predecessors, Haydn and Mozart, also believed in starting a symphony with a commanding sound, a major announcement of something to come. But Beethoven announces something on a scale of grandeur unknown to the others. He is announcing a heroic work, a monument. And what are these two chords, so commanding and brave? Simple triads in E flat major. Now, the physical laws of music are so constituted that triads turn out to be the chords on which our classical Western music has come to be based. All primitive wind instruments, for example, automatically produce the notes of the triad that evolve out of the fundamental note of the instrument. That is how bugle calls were born. If a bugle is built so that its fundamental note is E flat, then by maneuvering his lips, the bugler can produce the overtones of that E flat, and they will make the triad. As you see, there are only three different notes, but they go on repeating in order as the player goes higher, so that out of these three different notes can come reveille and taps and mess call and all the others. And also out of that simple triad comes the opening statement of the Eroica. Which brings us back to the big point, simplicity, the basic materials of music. Beethoven has taken a triad, a series of notes that couldn't be more basic, and made from it a theme which perhaps by itself is not what one might call a great melody. It is only the fact, the bugle call fact, out of which Beethoven is going to create his complex superstructure. Now, how does he do it? By taking this basic musical material and enlivening it, making it grow in oddly new ways, with constant surprises and twists and unexpected discoveries about it. It is this element of the unexpected that is so often associated with Beethoven, but the surprise is not enough. What makes it so great is that no matter how shocking and unexpected the surprise may be, it always somehow gives the impression, as soon as it has happened, that it is the only thing that could have happened at that moment. Inevitability is the keynote. It is as though Beethoven had an inside track to truth and rightness, so that he could say the most amazing and sudden things with complete authority and cogency. The first surprise comes immediately after the theme has been started. That is certainly the last note one could have expected here. But it is the note that throws the first fresh ray of light on the basic material of the preceding two bars. It is a wrench, an arbitrary, unprepared departure out of the home ground of the theme. Now, what has been accomplished? We have been given the premise of the whole work, struggle. Before 8 seconds of music have passed, we have already been involved in a conflict. There has been a stab of intrusive otherness, almost of pain, and then we have struggled back to normal within the next 8 seconds. But we now know what we are in for. This first movement is going to be a battle. Now Beethoven goes on to expand on his triad theme. But what new shocks have we had now? Rhythmic ones. Again, Beethoven is finding new meanings in his basic material. One of the basic elements is his meter. The whole movement goes in rapid groups of three, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, and so on. And the basic stress is naturally on 1-2-3, 1-2-3, like a waltz. But now we are suddenly hit by displaced accents, a kind of syncopation which makes the music go 1-2-3, 1-2-3, instead of the normal 1-2-3, 1-2-3. 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1. Then he goes on and does it even more elaborately.
1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3.
Each displaced accent is a shock, but all the shocks add up to an impetus that is pure Beethoven, exciting, new, and powerful. And all through a simple variation in the way of looking at 1-2-3. This syncopated passage leads us to a statement of the theme by the full orchestra. And we are now ready to leave this home ground to seek new material, new keys, and new subjects. What ordinarily happens at this point in the first movement of a classical symphony is that we embark on a transition section which will lead us to our second main theme. But Beethoven, the gigantic one, presents us with no less than three potent transition subjects, each one of which is meaningful enough to be called a theme in itself. And only then do we reach the second theme proper. The transition begins with this lyrical motive. The second element in the section burgeons out of the first, returning upwards the descending scale that fed into it. And now the third element. Remember, we are still in the transition between themes 1 and 2. And now we are finally ready for the tender, yearning second theme. Why does he need all those transitions? Let us experiment for a moment and see how the music would have flowed if only the first transition had been used. Actually, as you will see, it works perfectly well to leave out transitions 2 and 3. The key progression is right. Even the orchestration works out smoothly. It would sound like this. Excellent, you say? Yes, but not good enough for Beethoven, because he realized with that divine sensitivity of his that this lyrical transition motive does not set up the still more lyrical second theme. What is needed is a foil for this yearning, a sense of combat, the struggle we spoke of earlier, in order to point up more dramatically the contrasting tenderness to come. and this is well supplied by the agitated third section. So that when the theme finally arrives, it seems clothed in a new, refreshing glow. But even this contrast is not enough for him. In the second theme we have just heard, the wistful, longing character lasts a mere 16 bars when suddenly it stiffens in apprehension, like a wild animal that senses danger and bridles. You see how he carries on his sense of battle and conflict. He cannot leave the human condition pat and untouched in this music. There is no status quo. There is always the new danger, the all-too-short relaxation, then again the challenge, and again the riding off to meet it with a great battle cry. These elements of freshness are so abundant that it is difficult to choose among them. Take the famous hammer blow chords at the end of the exposition, the so-called barbaric dissonance. Again, Beethoven is dealing with a basic commodity of music, tonic chords and dominant chords. But he has channeled a new way and built a new sound simply by combining them simultaneously, giving a sense of pulling and tearing. In the middle of the raging development, having just concluded a staggering passage of blows and wounds, tearing at us with dissonances and displaced accents, Beethoven does a rather special thing. He introduces a brand new theme. By the strict rule, the development section should develop themes already stated in the exposition. But the giant in Beethoven takes over again and adds a new, almost elegiac melody, which is like a song of pain after the Holocaust. Again, it turns out that this new material was necessary to serve as a foil for the return of the original heroic theme. Gigantic, yes. Everything a little more, a little bigger, a little longer, a little stronger, but not one wasted note. Wasted note. Wasted.